We're delighted that you could join us today. I think events in Ukraine have made people more aware than ever of the importance of freedoms of expression, freedom of assembly, organization, all the things that people in Ukraine are so gallantly fighting for. And the Ukraine tragedy has made people ever more aware of China and its importance and what it's doing in Hong Kong. And it brings me back, when I see the fighting in Ukraine, to recall the fighting on the streets of Hong Kong before the national security law clamped down and made Hong Kong a kind of political cemetery. And of course, people in Taiwan, about whom there's now enormous concern, are very much watching what's going on in Hong Kong. So this is a very important session. My own attention has been so diverted in the last couple of weeks by what's going on in Europe that I haven't managed to keep up as much as I usually do with what's happening in Hong Kong. And I hope in the course of giving us reflection of your almost 30 years of experience based in Hong Kong, working in the entire Asian region, you'll also bring us up to date with what's happened lately. Mark, it's a great pleasure to see you, and this should be a lot of stimulating fun. Please start off with some thoughts you have. I'll interrupt you. We'll have a conversation, and then we'll let our distinguished audience have a chance to comment and question.
Great. Well, thank you, Jerry. Pleasure to see you. And thanks. We have a large audience today. Appreciate everybody taking the interest in discussing and thinking about Hong Kong, particularly given, of course, what's going on in the Ukraine. I think most people on this call will be aware that 2019 saw the most sustained protest against Chinese communist rule anywhere in China since 1949. I argue that it outstripped even the events of 1989. And although there was fighting, as you alluded to, Jerry, it wasn't really very violent. A handful of people died, none of them, as far as we've been able to confirm, at the hands of the police. So that's a big difference and something that we really should be thankful for. And I've reflected on that a lot in the last couple of weeks. And yet, your phrase about a political cemetery, a political graveyard, I think is very apt, because, you know, again, most people on this call, I think, will be familiar with Hong Kong. Many of you have lived there, and you know what a vibrant, open, free, freewheeling society it was. Of course, you know, Milton Friedman loved it for its adherence to laissez-faire. He thought it was the most perfect example of laissez-faire capitalism in the world. Perhaps not quite true, but it certainly was very, very successfully economically. And then, of course, politically, it was never a democracy, but it was a free society. And particularly in the later years of British rule, particularly the last 5 years when Chris Patten was governor, it got quite a good measure of democracy. Of course, Hong Kong people were promised universal suffrage. They were promised that they would be able to elect their mayor, you know, the chief executive, and their city council members, the legislative council, in a process of universal suffrage. And it's now clear that the Chinese never really had any intention of following through on that promise unless they could have been guaranteed of picking the winners. Here we are coming up on July 1st to halfway through the 50 years of the special administrative region, the enclave, the special status that was designed to promise to give Hong Kongers a high degree of autonomy. Deng Xiaoping said it would be Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. And of course, the result is really in less than 25 years, we've seen this wonderful free city essentially snuffed out. The events of 2019 were capped, I'm sure many of you will remember, with elections, district council elections in November, late November 2019. And after these months of millions of people coming out in the streets, increasingly tense, violent confrontations between police and protesters, the so-called silent majority that Beijing counted on, in fact, voted for the pro-democracy camp. And as in every election that Hong Kong has had since 1991, which I mark as sort of the beginning of elections in Hong Kong, certainly for the Legislative Council, almost six out of 10 people voted for the pro-democracy candidates. And that's remained remarkably consistent despite the difficulties, the tensions, the confrontations of 2019, despite an enormous amount of pressure by the government in favor of establishment candidates, the democracy camp still carried the day. And I think that that is indicative of the fact that most Hong Kong people, whether they're politically engaged, politically involved or not, they really want the freedom to be able to choose. Just like they can choose what to buy, they can choose where to work, they want the freedom to choose people who will elect them. Now, that dream or that goal is farther off than ever. With the introduction of the national security law, that following July 1st, we saw essentially the end of freedom in Hong Kong. And it was followed with the arrests of over 100 people under the national security law, scores of whom remain in prison, many of whom you probably have met, Jerry, or others on this call have, people like Claudia Mo, who just celebrated her 65th birthday in, I don't know if celebration is the right word, but her she was in prison for her 64th birthday and now her 65th birthday. Claudia is a former journalist who then went into politics. And in most countries, most societies, people like Claudia and others who are in prison would be lauded as active citizens. They were peaceful. They were trying to work within democratic system and processes. And for their pains, they're in jail. The situation has gone from bad to worse as a result of COVID. Hong Kong was in the midst of this extraordinary political crackdown, this unprecedented crackdown of a peaceful, prosperous, really open society that I don't think has ever been destroyed until Ukraine. So, I mean, we can talk later on about any possible parallels or what China or other people might learn from what's going on in Ukraine. But I'd say that, unfortunately, Ukraine has joined Hong Kong with the distinction of being the only place in modern history where for absolutely no reason, there's no war or anything. And a society has just been crushed. I mean, I think you have to look at perhaps Prague in 1968, Hungary in 1956 to see any sorts of parallels. Even the late 1940s period in Eastern Europe, at least one could argue was a post-war kind of situation. But in Hong Kong, there was absolutely no need, no reason to destroy the freedoms, except that Xi Jinping couldn't take the possibility that Hong Kong would be free and democratic. I think it's just too much of a challenge to his rule. And he's decided that Hong Kong is a troublesome peripheral region. People used to worry that Hong Kong would become just another Chinese city. I think Hong Kong would be lucky to have the fate to become a Shanghai or even a Chongqing. I think it's being treated like a troublesome peripheral region like Xinjiang or Tibet. And I think that the central authorities will just keep hammering Hong Kong into submission. The a recent appointment of the new People's Liberation Army commander in Hong Kong, who had a background as a commando, an elite killer unit, hunting down supposed separatists in Xinjiang, gives you an idea of the sorts of people that are being sent to deal with Hong Kong. The most recent challenge, though, and it's quite fundamental, and we don't know how it's going to turn out, is COVID. Hong Kong was forced to follow the zero COVID policy of the mainland. Carrie Lam has been almost desperate in opening up Hong Kong to the mainland without too much concern about the rest of the world. She's been willing to shut Hong Kong off from the rest of the world if she could get open to the mainland. That's proven impossible. And we now are getting tens of thousands of new cases a day in Hong Kong. The death rate in Hong Kong is higher than most other developed cities, countries, economies. And I think that it's really put the whole zero COVID strategy of China into doubt. And mainlanders are now down, more or less running the anti-COVID effort. And I think it's left her administration and really the whole government shattered. There's no opposition anymore, of course. So you can't blame it on the Democrats. And yet the government has proven incapable of dealing with this situation. So we have dead bodies piling up in hospital wards, mortuaries that are over full, people in some people in lockdown, the government having given up on its earlier policy of quite draconian style lockdowns. And we really don't know where Hong Kong is going from here. I mean, it seems to be more or less in free fall economically, politically, socially. The numbers of people leaving are, I don't know if they're at an all-time record, but I mean, tens of thousands, I think 70,000 last month left. So it's, this combination of politics and the pandemic have put Hong Kong in a situation that I think really has no parallel except for the beginning of World War II when the Japanese invaded and, of course, occupied Hong Kong. It's that kind of feeling. So I'll stop there and let's just turn it over to a conversation and Q&A, Jerry.
That's remarkable, Mark. I want to focus first on journalism. You have been both a distinguished journalist and a businessman in the journalism field. And you've seen the crackdown from both vantage points. Could you say something about, first of all, how does it look from the point of view of journalists used to freedom of expression and reporting? And then tell us about what happened with Jimmy Lai and with Apple Daily and now with other journalistic enterprises.
Yeah, well, thank you. Of course, an area close to my heart. I joined the board of directors of Next Digital, which published Apple Daily, the pro-democracy newspaper, in the spring of 2018. And I joined because I was interested in seeing the transition from a primarily print-driven paper to more of a digital one and wanted to be part of an important newspaper. Little did I imagine that I'd be caught up in the events of 2019 and 2020. Not in any sense that I wasn't involved with the newsroom or running things day to day, but as the authorities moved first to put Jimmy Lai in jail and later to arrest and jail many of the senior people at the newspaper and ultimately to shut the newspaper, in a foretaste of what the rest of the press had, the rest of the pro-democracy press had coming to it. So just a quick recap of events. Jimmy Lai was denied bail in December 2020 on fairly spurious charges and ones that definitely would not have resulted in imprisonment before conviction in an earlier era. In May of that year, May 2021, so about 9 months ago, he was essentially stripped of his rights as a shareholder. He owned 71% of the company, but the Secretary for Security wrote him and said that he couldn't exercise those rights anymore. I don't think this is, actually, I'm quite certain this has never happened in Hong Kong before, to strip somebody of their property without a due process. Now, the government will say it's due process because under the national security law, pretty much anything goes as long as the government wants to get you. They also tried to freeze three bank accounts, including overseas bank accounts, which is also an interesting use of state power. When we as directors said that we were continuing on, nothing to do with us, he was in jail, wasn't running the company, wasn't trading his shares, and it was business as usual, the government responded a couple of weeks later, so mid-June last year, by first sending 550 armed police into the newsroom, treating it like a crime scene, obviously terrifying journalists, taking computers, taking documents, and then a few days later, freezing key bank accounts. And this was all done on the say-so of the Secretary for Security. Then it was John Lee, who's since been promoted to the number two position in the government. And the bank accounts were frozen because Mr. Lee said he had, quote, reason to believe, that's it, reason to believe that the newspaper's activities had violated the national security law. So forget about all the promises China made in the basic law, which is the mini constitution that governs the territory. And it has guarantees free press, free speech, right to a jury trial, right to bail, right to be considered innocent until proven guilty. All those things just went out the window. So here we were with our bank accounts frozen, our lawyers, or the bank accounts for the three key operating companies frozen. The lawyers telling us, our lawyers saying that if we used money in other accounts to pay, let's see, China Light and Power and the electricity bill, the telephone bill, our 600 journalists, if we tried to pay them through other means, those accounts would be deemed contaminated and frozen. We had 600,000 digital subscribers in a city of 7.5 million. I mean, we're making this digital transition that I thought would be so difficult, and it proved much easier than dealing with the political challenges we faced. So there we were. A week later, staff was terrified. We had, at that point, our editor-in-chief was also in jail. Our chief executive officer, who had been editor-in-chief earlier, was in jail. By the time the dust settled, the newspaper was shut, and we had and have seven people in jail, none of them convicted of anything, with the exception of Jimmy Lai, who was subsequently convicted on some civil disobedience charges. So pretty nice way of dealing with a newspaper. You freeze the bank accounts and throw the top people in jail.
How did you elude imprisonment?
There was an earlier raid in August 2020, just after the national security law came into effect. And and 200 or so people, police came in and took away a number of the staff. And I realized at one point that I was the only director in Hong Kong not in police custody. So that didn't make me feel too good. It happened to be that a couple of months later, I left Hong Kong for a kind of end of the year holiday at the end of that first pandemic year. And that's where I was when I saw Jimmy manacled, taken off to jail, his bail denied. And among many, many reasons that the prosecutor adduced to deny him bail were some comments that I'd made. So that tended to focus my mind in terms of not returning to Hong Kong anytime soon.
Your mention of bail so many times makes it important for us to make clear to people one of the most immediate and important changes that the national security law promulgated was the change in the traditional common law bail policy, because the NSL made it clear there's a presumption against granting bail. And what that means is the government's in a great position. It can accuse anybody of anything, and that locks them up. And it may take 2 or 3 years or even more before that person is finally adjudicated. And even if the person is successful with the help of the best courageous lawyers, it means the person will have already been punished for several years and then declared not guilty. So this is a they can't lose policy for the government. It gives them immense power. And now what we've witnessed, even in cases that are not brought under the national security law, if sedition under the traditional Hong Kong colonial law is charged, the court recently ruled, the Court of Final Appeal, that bail should be presumptively denied in those cases. So this is a sledgehammer, and it's one of the basic denials of freedom and justice that the national security law has really implemented here. Tell us about other journalists, not the problems of the newspapers, but people who work for distinguished foreign media. What has happened to them? I remember there was a problem when they refused to admit back into Hong Kong the man who'd been the head of the Foreign Correspondents Club. And I wonder how long the Foreign Correspondents Club can last. I used to give many talks there. It's a place perhaps I'm the fondest of in Hong Kong. And I'm wondering what your reflections are on the plight of international journalists in Hong Kong.
That's a great question. You were referring to Victor Mallet from the Financial Times, who actually he was the number two, and he just happened to be the officer, the presiding officer, when I think it was Andy Ho from a pro-independence political party spoke at the FCC. So his sin for being the moderator of that session was to essentially be driven out of Hong Kong, had his visa denied, was denied entry at the airport. This sort of thing had never happened before. There were, of course, times during the British colonial period where if you were a journalist with one of the communist newspapers, it wasn't too easy. But Hong Kong, of course, had always been a great Asian center, really a great international center for foreign correspondents. Well, sign of the times is that the New York Times has moved much of its editorial operation that had been in Hong Kong to Seoul, South Korea. And Jerry, you and I both spent time in Seoul in the 1980s. I think you were even there during the 1970s. And the idea that a place that had been so authoritarian just a generation ago would now be home to an editorial center for the New York Times in preference to Hong Kong is almost unthinkable, but I think is a dramatic illustration of how much Hong Kong has changed. It's much more difficult. The Times moved because they were having trouble getting visas for their journalists. Hong Kong Free Press, a tiny little organization, but one that really punches above its weight, had to give up on getting visas for somebody they wanted to hire. I mean, this completely goes against the tradition of Hong Kong, its tradition of freedom, its ability for people, even foreigners, to get work visas relatively easily. And of course, I think it augurs, very, very badly for the future of international journalism as well. As for the FCC itself, well, some senior people, notably the former chief executive C.Y. Lung, have long and publicly, loudly questioned why the FCC should be used by, why it should exist in what are government-owned premises that are rented out, leased by the FCC. So it'll be interesting to see, but one would imagine that its days are numbered. Question is it a matter of months or of decades? I would think that when the lease comes up next, it's a multi-year lease, that there would certainly be issues. But I just, before we go on, I want to not forget all the Hong Kong journalists who worked for not just the 600 or so journalists who worked for Apple Daily, but the hundreds of others who worked for things like Stan News, Citizen News. All these, they were not traditional media. They are often online media, but these are really courageous, gutsy people. Many of them have been forced to leave Hong Kong. Those that are still there are, not surprisingly, changed professions.
What about radio? What about TV?
Well, good question. The dominant broadcaster, of course, is RTHK, the old Radio Television Hong Kong, which used to be extremely independent, and that's now been totally politicized. There is some independent radio still. I think the days are numbered for that. But, the whole space for public discussion, for discourse is narrowing. And it's, again, it's sad. And I think what's surprising is not that China took a tough line towards Hong Kong, but kind of how thoroughly and how brutally and how quickly this was accomplished with, I'm sorry to say, the help of senior leaders in the Hong Kong government who seem to have just gone along willingly with the destruction of their city.
RTHK used to call me for interviews, but once the new law came out, they stopped. And I've often wondered, how long can Hong Kong Free Press last? They're asking for donations. Can they take foreign donations?
You know, just the fact that we have to ask that question is an indication of how much things have changed. I think all of us who have friends or contacts in Hong Kong now have to worry, oh, if I give someone money, does this cause problems for them? If I call this person, does this cause problems for them? You know, is my bank account going to be frozen? I mean, these are the sorts of things that would have been unthinkable just 2 or 3 years ago.
What about social media? If one gives one's views on Hong Kong social media, is that monitored? Is that censored?
Well, I can't give you a really great answer on that. Certainly, as soon as somebody's arrested, the police have their phone and then they go through it. So we do know that's a major issue. Is it being monitored in real time? I don't know. Is the internet now starting to be blocked? Yes. As a matter of fact, Hong Kong Watch, a terrific NGO based in the UK, just was cut off a week or two ago. And I think that's still in existence. So we're starting to see the great firewall being extended to include Hong Kong as well. Again, another nail in the coffin.
What if I send an email after this broadcast to a colleague at Hong Kong University Law School? Is that email read by the security authorities?
I think it depends who your colleague is. I'd say increasingly yes. I mean, they have a budget of over $1 billion for a city of 7.5 million people for national security law enforcement. There are hundreds of people who are looking at people like you and me, but above all, of course, looking at Hong Kong Chinese. I mean, the other important thing to remember is China says that the national security law can be applied to everyone, everywhere. They could decide, Jerry, that they want to come after you, theoretically, and pick you up at an airport in Thailand, put a red notice out for you and pick you up at an airport in Thailand or other places where they have extradition arrangements. They haven't, I mean, We have to be clear here. Ethnic Chinese are the ones who are really bearing the brunt of this. And the authorities in Hong Kong have made it clear that they will use the national security law to go after people like Nathan Law, Brian Leung, other dissidents who left Hong Kong rather than face so-called justice in the Hong Kong courts. I think that people like you and me, at least for the moment, are probably okay, but part of China is to keep us guessing, right? We don't know if there are arrest warrants out. You don't know when you're going to be picked up. And under the NSL, I mean, again, anything anywhere can be used against someone. There's a young woman, well, late 20s, who's in jail now. She was a speech therapist, and she and some of her colleagues did a children's book, and it featured some sheep and some wolves. The government has decided that was a parable and it was inciting hatred against the government. Therefore, she was arrested under the national security law. And as you pointed out very eloquently, the presumption was against bail. So she's been in jail for about a year or so, awaiting trial. And to circle back to one other point you made, these trials are a long time off. And so part of the strategy seems to be to get people to plead guilty so they can claim, oh, they're guilty. They pled guilty because, as you say, people are being held for years. And even if they were by some miracle acquitted, they still would have lost years of their life. So it's a very, very insidious tool.
You know, I used to be a federal prosecutor when I was a young lawyer. And ever since then, I've been aware the power to prosecute, to bring an indictment, regardless of the outcome of the trial, is the power to destroy. We've really just witnessed in New York, as you probably know, a decision by the local prosecutor's office not to bring charges against Trump for inflating his real estate and falsifying accounts, et cetera. In Hong Kong, the decision to prosecute has been taken over by national security officials who don't even allow the usual prosecutors in Hong Kong to know what's going on. And the former director of public prosecutions resigned in protest because he wasn't even being told what this secret group within the Department of Justice was going to do with respect to deciding whether or not to prosecute someone. So this is a very powerful force. But now we shouldn't forget trial. If a case finally comes to trial, will there be trial by jury if it's a secret, important charge, a very prominent charge? They can take away your right to trial by jury. Then you're tried by three judges who were not picked at random, but who are only on the list that really is designated by the CEO, chief executive of Hong Kong, after advice from the national security authorities. So you get special judges instead of a jury trial.
I think it's really terrific that you are able to articulate some of these things that look like they're small changes, but are so important. Again, read the basic law. I'm sure you have, Jerry. Right, trial by jury. It's guaranteed in there. And yet somehow the law has been twisted in a way that no one, we've only had a handful of national security law charges, no one has had a jury. And unfortunately, that's the precedent. And I remember in the first case, Tong Yin Kit, a few months ago, it was said that because the safety of the jurors couldn't be guaranteed, well, no need for a jury trial. It sounds like a pretty specious excuse for me, but it ensured that everything was in the hands of the presiding judge. In some cases, I guess you're right, Jerry, they do have three. So far, I believe all the cases have only had one judge. And, you know, these are, as you say, handpicked judges and presumably quite politically reliable. I do want to say, you mentioned the director of public prosecutions who resigned when the NSL came in. I applaud him. I know none of the details, but I've read much of what you alluded to, and I applaud him for that. But what's sad to me is how few officials in Hong Kong have resigned, whether judges or government officials. Many low and middle ranking officials have taken early retirement, resigned, gone abroad. But the principal officials, whether they're in the economic area or the political area, seem to just be soldiering on, ready to collect their pensions and do Beijing's bidding. And that's quite sad because, of course, those of us who spent time in Hong Kong know these people. We know people like Carrie Lam, and it's almost the most dismal and unbelievable part of all this is the way in which the Hong Kong elite has just seemingly willingly gone along with the destruction of their city.
See, not only has the independence of the judiciary been circumscribed and narrowed, but the best defense people in Hong Kong have, as you well know, is the barristers, the criminal defense lawyers who compose the Bar Association. And the Bar Association is under continuing, ever more severe attack. And we've just witnessed that the former head of the Bar Association, Paul Harris, has been chased out of Hong Kong after being called in for what in the mainland is usually regarded as come in for a cup of tea with the security officers. And he was invited in to meet with the security police. And that night he flew to the UK. And that's a very sinister sign.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's part of a pattern we've seen where there will be an attack in Dagong Bao or Wen Wei Bao, the two most prominent Chinese communist newspapers in Hong Kong. Usually it's followed up with one or two prominent either mainland officials or Hong Kong officials who are seen as close to the mainland. And then it's followed up with an arrest or if not an arrest, an invitation for tea, and people get the message. And so we've seen scores of civil society, NGOs, political organizations, some of the newspaper, the media organizations I mentioned before, they'll preemptively shut down. And then the government's able to say, nothing to do with us. I mean, they made the decision independently to shut down. And I should say that in the case of Apple Daily and Next Digital, they seem desperate to prove that there's still freedom of the press and that the shutdown of the paper had to do because lousy directors like me and our crummy managers just ran the paper into the ground. So, but to back that up, We are the subject of four investigations, and you mentioned prosecution. The directors, at least the independent non-executive directors of which I was one, have not been prosecuted, but we have to hire lawyers. We have to deal with investigators. Even directors from some of the subsidiary companies have been hounded. So it's really incredible to be on the wrong end of a government, a state wielding a stick, and they've got the power. They have the power to prosecute, as you say, Jerry. They have the power to make life very miserable, costly, scary for people on the other end of it.
What bothers me especially is how many of the barristers are now being intimidated into silence. Even the former director of public prosecutions who resigned because he was being excluded from knowledge of what's going on in his own office, he has not spoken out at any length because he's returned to be a practitioner. And you can't practice law as a barrister if the government is going to crack down on your law firm, on your group. It's a very dangerous situation. So I wonder, what about the extraterritorial reach? I was struck by your remark that you not only have to be careful if you're an external foreign critic of what's taking place in Hong Kong, about going back to Hong Kong, but maybe you shouldn't go to Bangkok, or maybe you shouldn't go to a number of other places in the world where Hong Kong might be able to extradite you. Although extradition agreements with Hong Kong were quickly suspended by the United States and many other liberal democracies, there are many other countries that have not.
Yeah.
And a red notice can cause you a lot of difficulty traveling in other countries. Do you feel constricted in your travel plans?
Well, I guess one of the only good things about COVID is that we're not traveling as much. So I wouldn't say I personally felt constricted, but I recently met Bill Browder, who, of course, was the Russian hedge fund manager whose lawyer, Sergei Magnitsky, was killed in a Russian custody. And Browder became a tireless crusader for human rights and got the Magnitsky Act through, which allows for sanctioning of individual officials by legislatures. And Browder had met with some of the Hong Kong democracy people a couple of years ago. He told me it was only one meeting, I believe, one or two meetings, just a couple of individuals. And the Foreign Office in the UK warned him about this situation. And Reuters, I believe it was, ran a map, and it showed in red all the places where if Browder had a red notice against him by the Russians, who, of course, have had red notices against him, and he was arrested in Spain as a result of one of these spurious Interpol red notices. So, you know, Browder is a pretty big part of the globe that he has to worry about going to. So, it, as I say, it hasn't really come up yet, but it's certainly something that one has to consider.
Tell me, Christina, it's time for questions and comments. And would you please arrange for the first commentator?
Hi, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Alvin Chung, NYU and McGill. I have a comment and a question. The comment is, I have to say, I'm not surprised at all by the number of officials and judges who are happy to go along with what is happening. What we see from the likes of Vichy France is there will never be any shortage of willing collaborators. Now, my question is this. I've had the good fortune of sitting in on CFR sessions on Hong Kong for almost a decade. One of the most consistent responses I hear from certain regulars, and they know who they are, is to downplay developments in the territory or to blame the victims. To what extent has that sort of response facilitated the imposition of the NSL and what we see today? And what would you say to the people who've been consistently downplaying developments in the territory?
That's a great question. It's very interesting about blaming the victims. I've never quite understood why people who went out and protested for decades, protested amazingly peacefully, why it's their fault that when they asked for what they were promised in international agreements, the Sino-British Declaration, and of course the Basic Law as a a foundational law for Hong Kong, why they should be blamed. I think that sows, certainly by sowing that seed of uncertainty and of doubt, both within Hong Kong and outside, it of course makes it easier for the national security law to be imposed. It's been remarkable to me the kind of misinformation and disinformation. I mean, of course, one also hears in certain quarters, a little less so now, that it's all the fault of the CIA, which has always struck me as rather laughable. I wasn't, of course, a frontline participant, but I saw a lot of what was going on in the streets in 2019. And I can assure you that the CIA has never done anything with that degree of organizational, kind of grassroots organizational skill. And I think it's really a testament, you know, what happened on the streets of Hong Kong is a testament to having, you know, a really switched on, educated, technology savvy, literate population that, you know, grew up in a climate of freedom. And I think that is the thing that's made it hard for China to crack down. But as you say, there's never a shortage of collaborators. There are always a certain number of people who just want stability. And when you have a guy like Xi Jinping, who, let's not forget, Xi Jinping and Vladimir Putin are risk takers of a sort that we don't usually see in large states. We're used to seeing them in small kind of what we call rogue nations. And Xi Jinping has gambled or taken risks again and again. South China Sea would be one example, in Hong Kong another, in Xinjiang, and he's been getting away with it. So I think that's really at the heart of the problem. I think absent Xi Jinping, Hong Kong would certainly be facing, would be constricted. I don't think it was going to get democracy, but it wouldn't have had the scale, the breadth, the swiftness of the NSL, and it's the way it's been carried out.
Next question, please.
The next question is coming from Gordon Krovitz.
Great, thank you so much, and wonderful to see both of you. I wanted to underscore one thing that Mark said, and then Jerry, I wanted to ask you a question, and I have one for Mark, if I'm allowed to do all of that. One of the things that Mark said earlier is that Apple Daily had 600,000 paying subscribers to its digital version in Hong Kong. That's, you know, roughly just under 10% of the population of Hong Kong, including children. The equivalent in the United States would be if the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times had 30 million subscribers, which is about 10 times what either of them actually has. So as somebody who had the pleasure and occasional displeasure of serving on the next digital board with Mark, one of the things that I think both of us were stunned by was how Hong Kong people voted with their credit card to subscribe to Apple Daily as soon as that became the business model. And I think it's as close to a democratic vote as Hong Kong got to have in the last few years. Jerry, a question for you. You mentioned bail and the unbelievable shift in that regard. When Mark laid out how the national security law was used to freeze Jimmy Lai's shares, to tell the company it couldn't spend money to keep itself operating. Under the national security law, that was all done without a court order. It was all done on the signature of one official, Secretary for National Security. And as we were going through that, I was scratching my head and thinking to myself, isn't there some law against that? And Jerry, neither of us was around at the time, but Magna Carta, one of the reforms of Magna Carta in 1215 was that neither life nor property could be taken without a court order. So I now come back to my question for Mark, which is the title of your book is Today Hong Kong, Tomorrow the World. We saw what the Chinese Communist Party was willing to do in Hong Kong. What lessons should we draw from that?
Gordon, your question to me reminds me, and this is an illustration, the courts are open. They're independent. You can challenge orders like that. But the problem is, even if you make a persuasive case that those orders violate the Constitution of Hong Kong, given what its legal system has been and what the basic law guarantees, you can't win because the courts in Hong Kong have lost the power to make the final decision on whether government arbitrary action is indeed in violation of the Constitution. That is clearly now the power of the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress. So all this talk about the courts are still independent, but their jurisdiction, their power is being shrunk.
Well, and another way.
The jury trial is being shrunk. We see all this happening. So a lot of it is really empty talk. I'm glad you mentioned Mark's book, because as I told him earlier, the Council on Foreign Relations does not review books that have not been published by the Council. Nevertheless, we should note, as you point out, and as Mark's background shows, I think I see a copy of the book behind his right ear. And it is indeed something about tomorrow the world. What have you got in mind there? I remember when I was a kid, about 1939 or 40, my parents took me to a Broadway play. I think it was called Tomorrow the World, because the theme was obviously Hitler and what he was a man. What have you got in mind in making such a provocative title, Mark? And can that book be published and sold in Hong Kong?
Well, actually, I did hear that it's on sale at Hong Kong Book Center, which surprised me. I know some people have mail ordered it. So I guess all is not totally lost yet in Hong Kong. But of course, English language books are not subject to quite the same scrutiny. I think that what we've seen in Hong Kong is sophisticated, obviously it's been quite blunt sometimes, but a way of crushing a free society by using the courts and legal system and bullying rather than concentration camps, internment camps, bullets, the kinds of things we're seeing in Xinjiang and in Ukraine. And what concerns me is not that China is going to have going to be having autonomy over, let's say, Lithuania, but the way that China wants to redraw the bounds of debate in democratic open societies. And we could talk about Australia, where simply the call by the prime minister 2 years ago for there to be an international investigation into the origins of COVID, something, by the way, that, of course, China said that it wanted, and I think the world desperately needs an answer to, that was enough to provoke China's fury and cut off many of Australia's most important agricultural exports, wine, beef, barley. Of course, they kept buying iron ore, which the Chinese need, and when they needed it, they also bought Australian coal. Lithuania, the case in Australia, it's a big economy. It's, you know, obviously very robust. They've been debating how to deal with China for decades. The Lithuanian example is more recent and in some ways more troubling. I mean, this is a small, far off, you know, Baltic nation of a couple million people, far off from China, had the temerity in China's eyes to open a trade office, a Taiwan trade office, and to use the word Taiwan rather than to use the word Taipei. And for that, exports or imports from Lithuania to China were literally zeroed out. The authorities in Beijing simply eliminated the country code as part of the customs in an import. So Lithuania literally did not exist as far as China was concerned. And China said, we didn't cut any imports off, and because, you know, the country, the numerical code doesn't exist. And they've gone on to demand that German automakers stop sourcing even components from Lithuania that will be used in cars that are sold in China. So all the might of a country you know, of 1.4 billion people, Lithuania's population is barely a rounding error, not even a rounding error for China. And they're trying to crush Lithuania, and they're actually putting the EU, EU unity at risk. And of course, they're torpedoing the investment agreement that was it was agreed in draft form a couple of years ago between China and the EU, something that China had said for years that it wanted. So going to the Czech Republic, you know, many other countries, we're seeing kind of bullying and intimidation. I just want to mention one more, which is Sweden, where mainland-born guy who held Swedish citizenship, Gui Minhai, was living in the southern Thailand. You mentioned Thailand before, Jerry, city of Pattaya. He was kidnapped, abducted from Thailand, seemingly moved across the border through Cambodia, and surfaced in China. I believe this was in 2015. He was abducted in late 2015. He surfaced in China, said that he wanted to deal with a traffic accident that resolved that he'd been involved in some years before. And the end is he has renounced his Swedish citizenship, seemingly under duress, and is being held in China. And when Swedish journalists and politicians try to question this, several successive ambassadors to Sweden have, you know, really threatened Sweden in the most, you know, undiplomatic terms. I was just in the UK last week. We're seeing, you know, the stories one hears even in places like Scotland about the bullying that Hong Kongers are enduring at the hands of mainlanders is, you know, really not to be believed. So I think it doesn't mean that, you know, China is going to be dictating, you know, rent, you know, housing policy in New York City, but it does mean that if current trends continue, that even places like New York and London are going to see their freedoms constricted. I mean, just one final example. When I was in Edinburgh, I heard that one of the top officials wasn't allowed to attend a Taiwan Day independence celebration. And it's that kind of behavior where democratic politicians in democratic countries are being told that they can't do something they would normally do for fear of offending the Chinese.
This even affects social relations in New York, and not for the first time recently. I remember a program not long ago, I was running one of these roundtables at the council, maybe 3 or 4 years ago. Former Chinese ambassador to Washington, who's still a high-level official in Beijing, asked for the opportunity to talk at the council. And we gave him that opportunity. But they didn't want a Taiwan TECO representative who normally attends our roundtables to attend. And the ambassador said, "If that person attends, I will not speak." I said, "Okay, you were the one who wanted to speak. I didn't ask you to speak." And in the end, he came and spoke, and the TECO representative was there. And of course, in 2013 and 14, when the Chinese government suspected I was sponsoring the blind barefoot lawyer, Chen Wangcheng, and his plan to visit Taiwan, which I wasn't, I was simply telling him if he goes, he should see some law people. The Beijing government told its diplomats in America they should not attend any dinner or program in which I took part. And of course, the American organizations resisted that. So this is not entirely new, but it has intensified under Xi Jinping for the last decade. Could we have the next question?
Next question is coming from Sharon Holm.
Hi, thank you, Mark, and thank you, Jerry, for this important conversation at a particularly disheartening and difficult time for the world. I like Jerry, and I think probably many others, I've been so intensely focused by the aggression against the Ukraine people. And I've been thinking about the comments both of you have been sharing. And I have a quick comment, and I'd like to ask a broader question. I think that since 2014 and then 2019 in particular, the Hong Kong, let's say, democracy movement or the Hong Kong People's Movement, you know, very much presented itself as today Hong Kong, tomorrow the world, which is, Mark, your title of your book. And that, you know, many of us felt that Hong Kong was the front line for defending democratic institutions in Asia, particularly against Beijing's encroachment. But what we're hearing today a lot is Ukrainian people saying, today Ukraine, tomorrow the world. So we have Putin and Xi Jinping first, you know, crushing a particular place, and then the threat of the world. But I'm wondering if the trends of this expansion of bullying by China, you know, this transnational repression, as it's, you know, clearly been developing, is it so clear that it's inevitable? Is it so clear that it's going to expand as business as usual? Because it seems that the governments in particular, Sweden, Germany, Finland, Switzerland, you know, governments that we would have thought unthinkable to have taken the actions they have taken, and companies, which frankly would have been unthinkable just a few weeks ago, to divest, to cut off their services, Netflix, you know, Apple, all of these companies. Now, these are unthinkable a few weeks ago. And then I think I've heard some people just dismiss that by saying, well, they don't have the investments in China. They don't have as much to lose if they take these necessary actions. But is it really? And that the criticisms of 20 years of appeasement, appeasing Putin, has now come home to roost. And I think there was a lot of parallels with appeasing of China, of Beijing, and that many of the mass atrocities and violations had no consequences. So this is what we're seeing. And so there are these parallels, and notwithstanding China trying to walk an impossible neutral line with Ukraine, you know, abstaining from the Security Council vote, abstaining in the Human Rights Council vote. My question is, can it really, with the pressure it's getting from all around, not just from the US, even from its, you know, not having great relations, Australia is pressuring them. I mean, is it, can they escape it, given that today was the beginning of the Paralympics and they censored the president of the Paralympics' powerful anti-war message? And then now they're getting backlash from Chinese citizens against this wolf warrior narrative that they will protect Chinese citizens anywhere, but they didn't warn their 6,000 Chinese nationals in the Ukraine, and they still haven't gotten everyone out, and the sense, you know, the social media censorship. So I think my question is, there seems to be a lot of policy commentary that the world has changed, not just because of COVID, but has changed because of Putin's war of aggression in Ukraine. And that we're all going to be thinking that there are some global geopolitical shifts. And so the question is any of that a potential lever? Are there any ways we could begin thinking about it? And Jerry, are we definitely at the political graveyard, or is it just like the political graveyard is like a bombed out village and city and town, but the game isn't over? When you see all that bombed out homes and hospitals and schools, you don't hear the Ukrainian people say it's over. In fact, they're ready. And you may remember Alexander Vindman, born in the Ukraine, former director for European affairs for the US National Security Council. He just published a recent argument why America must do more. But what I thought I'd share as a preface to hear your thoughts is he ends his argument why America must do more by saying it may be too soon for optimism, but there's still reason for hope. And although hope is not a strategy, hopelessness guarantees defeat. So I really want to encourage and hear both of you, as I know you both have in you, to share some thoughts of strategic, just ideas that might feel as hopeless as it is, you know, that maybe things are shifting in a way that might be useful to us who care about the future of Hong Kong and human rights.
Mark, do you want to take a first crack at that?
I was hoping that you would. First of all, Sharon, thank you. You know, very eloquently put. My day job is as president of the Committee for Freedom in Hong Kong, which was set up a year ago this month to focus on political prisoners. First of all, the idea that 3 years ago we'd be talking about political prisoners in Hong Kong was, you know, well, there was no thought of that. We have not been successful, I have to confess, in getting political prisoners out, but we're not going to give up. And I think that, I mean, nothing lasts forever, and tyrannies are not immune from that law. I think that the strategy is we hew to what we know is right, to the precepts of open societies, liberal democracy, and keep fighting for that. And we don't accept the fact that people try to crush freedoms, throw people like Jimmy Lai in jail. I mean, just 1 second on Jimmy Lai, because he is one of the prisoners who I know. He's 74 years old. He's a diabetic. He's a devout Roman Catholic. He's preached nothing but nonviolence his whole life. He's everything that a Hong Kong success story should be, a 12-year-old illegal immigrant, smuggled himself in a sampan, worked himself up, you know, first had a textile factory, then a clothing chain he started before he went into media. This is the kind of person that the government wants to has thrown in jail. And I think we just keep fighting, and that's all we can do. We're lucky that we're in a country where we're still able to talk. We're still able to have conversations like this, because obviously if we were in Russia or China or Hong Kong or Ukraine, it would be, you know, very challenging, to say the least. So it's the tactics, I think I understand better than the strategy, but the strategy is we keep playing for time, and we have truth and justice on our side. And that's proven to be pretty effective over many, many centuries. It's hard to be optimistic in the short term. And in the long run, of course, we're all dead, but we hope for something in between that will be for a better time. But I do agree with you, Sharon. I mean, I think what Putin has done has really put in very sharp relief where appeasement gets one, especially with dictators, leaders who run large countries. And I think it's really sharpened the focus on China's behavior. I think it's, history has been moving very fast in the last couple of weeks. It's way too early to say what the impact is going to be on China. But, you know, as we all know, this is a country with, you know, significant internal weaknesses. Far be it for me to kind of predict where it's going to play out, but I think it's a very challenging time for Xi Jinping.
Sharon, as you know, roughly a decade before the Bolshevik Revolution, Lenin wrote a book called What is to be Done? And we're faced with that with respect to all these problems. But as you point out, we have a new heightened climate of greater unity among the freedom-loving countries. But it still doesn't solve the problem of what to do. That doesn't mean NATO is going to go to war to save Ukraine. We have to worry it could even mean that Putin could raise to the nuclear level his effort to save Ukraine. And what to do about Hong Kong? To what extent do we have greater potential for doing things? I think at the UN we might. Elsewhere in international law, but we're limited in what we can do. We're talking now about the extent to assure the freedom of Taiwan. And we see all manner of proposals are now being made in the new emotional climate that appreciates to a greater degree than ever the virtues of democracy. I'm for doing everything we can to bolster Taiwan's security and freedom, but without unnecessarily provoking Beijing to test it through war. And that's why I was shocked at the statement former Secretary of State Pompeo made in Taipei the other day about we should establish formal diplomatic relations with Taiwan. Well, that's an invitation to war. It's putting a red flag in front of a bull. So the fact that we have this new climate, and I think it may be advantageous on the whole, despite the sacrifice of Ukraine that's causing it, doesn't solve the problem of what policies now to add to those we haven't, to those we've already produced. So this is a wild, stimulating time. Let's have another question, please.
Next question is coming from Donald Fox.
Thank you, Mark. I look forward to reading your book. Thank you, Jerry, for organizing the program. I learned a great deal. I'm a lawyer and the chairman of the U.S. branch of the International Commission of Jurists. I don't have a speech. I just have two short questions. In the first place, Mark, you said that many of the elite have just settled in Hong Kong, taking their pensions and keeping their heads low. Have any of them gone abroad, and are they engaging in efforts to keep the ideal of liberty and freedom in mind for all the expatriate people from Hong Kong? I mean, have any of them retained enough of their courage and entrepreneurship to really continue to keep connections with the overseas community and remind them that one day it's possible to change? And the second question is also very simple. You said people are emigrating all the time. And I'm sure they do. Who are the dissidents who remain? And if they are dissidents who want to leave, can they get a visa to leave?
Yeah, excellent questions. Thanks for that. There are definitely people who have left. I would single out, I think, some high-profile legislators. They were actually people who were kicked out in most cases from the Legislative Council. Some of them were able to go abroad. Nathan Law is one. He's fairly young, in his late 20s. Dennis Kwok is a legal sector. He represented the legal sector. He was elected by lawyers for that functional constituency. He's in the States. Charles Mock represented the IT sector. And is also now in the States. There are Ted Hoy escaped and is in another former legislator in Australia. So many of these people are politically active, politically engaged. And of course, there are many journalists, students, and others. 71,000 people, I believe, left last month, so about 1% of the population. There's a diaspora of a sort that is rarely seen in history, I think, and technology is allowing it to be linked on a global basis. So I'd say there are lots of sort of kind of scattered diaspora groups rather than a kind of organized like government in exile or anything like that. There are, you know, quite a few other people. I mean, I should, you know, also mention, you know, quite a few of the student dissidents left. For people who, most of the people who are in Hong Kong, who are kind of high profile dissidents, are in jail right now. Some of them might be out on bail, but you know, those people can't leave. Are there people who would like to leave who you know, can't get a visa? Maybe. I mean, at Apple Daily, we had somebody who had quit the newspaper, but was arrested at the airport as he tried to fly to London last end of June, beginning of July. So I think and I do know people who were able to get out who are, and this is probably more common, keeping a very low profile because of fear of relatives back in Hong Kong. I mean, I've met numerous people like that. People from Apple Daily and just ordinary people are really concerned. I've met a couple recently, guys in their 20s, 30s, and they've had to cut off relations with their mothers, with their parents, because the government will put pressure on the, you know, old trick, right? And it's been done in the mainland for a long time. I see Jerry sort of nodding, you know, put pressure on the parents who are supposed to tell the kid to behave or else the parent can pay the price. And the only way to deal with that is cut off relations with your mother so that the government can't pressure her. Very, very sad. I mean, actually a sick way of running your politics, I think.
Or get your mother out of Hong Kong.
Yeah.
You see, I've been worrying for a long time whether the government is going to impose an exit ban. The spectacle of hundreds of thousands of people leaving Hong Kong, and several hundred thousand have already done that. If that goes on, at one point will the regime think, well, on the one hand, it's good to get rid of dissidents. On the other hand, what a shameful loss of face it is in front of the world. And you'll notice how mainland China has imposed exit ban forever. And so exit ban, I think, is on the future agenda that we'll have to think about. In the meantime, this discussion makes me think of Martin Lee, who with Jimmy Lai was here, spoke with us 2.5 years ago. Martin has been convicted, but he got a suspended sentence, apparently because one good thing about Chinese tradition, and I may be relying on it myself, is if you're over 80, they're very reluctant to sentence you to prison. And Martin got a suspended sentence, but I haven't heard from Martin for a long time. That raises the question, even for those who get suspended sentence so they don't have to do time, what are the terms that circumscribe their behavior? What can they say without running the risk of being rearrested and this time kept in prison? And look at Margaret Ng, the same thing. I remember before she studied law, she came to talk to me in Hong Kong. I took her to dinner about whether a good journalist should take some time off to study law. And I urged her to do so. And what wonderful uses she has made of her combination of law and journalism. But now she's silent. It also raises the question on bail, even for those who've been lucky enough not to be denied bail, despite the new NSL provisions. What are the terms of the bail? What are they free to say on bail that won't get them a loss of bail? So there's so many restrictions, most of which we're unaware of. And cumulatively, they have led to silence in Hong Kong.
I think well put. And I don't know the terms, but I would imagine that it's vague. And since the national security law itself is vague and all-encompassing, essentially it's whatever they want it to be. If you say something that's effective, then that's probably grounds to revoke your bail. And again, you mentioned Margaret and Martin. I mean, these are such extraordinary people. And in any society, any normal open society, they would be celebrated, feted for their commitment to community service and to making society better. And here they are instead convicted, hoping that they won't actually have to serve time behind bars. And it's particularly bad now because of the COVID lockdown. I think over 1,000 prisoners have been infected. The courts are closed until April 11th. I believe it's April 11th, which again is, justice delayed, justice denied. I know Jimmy Lai has had a trial that's been put off. And by the way, he's in solitary confinement in a maximum security prison, put in 30, 35 pounds of manacles, of chains, every time he has to make a court appearance. I mean, this is the way that, a man who's preached nonviolence his whole life is treated by the Chinese state.
Next question, please.
Next question is coming from Sheridan Prasso.
Hi, thanks very much for this wonderful discussion. I'm going to ask a question as one of the hundreds of thousands of people who also had to leave Hong Kong recently. And Jerry, to your earlier question about independent journalism in Hong Kong, I was one of the people as well who was no longer able to continue to work there as a journalist. It became very apparent. after the passage of the national security law. So I'm now back in the US in Washington. I wanted to ask you, Mark, about opposition and its current status. And we've seen just in the last couple of weeks, the kind of foreign bankers community suddenly starting to voice a little bit of opposition to the Hong Kong government, whereas they had been silent and even welcoming previously of the efforts at crackdown to make Hong Kong, of course, more a stable place to do business. And we've seen the likes of Alan Zeman, the founder of Lan Kwai Fong, just write a letter to Carrie Lam in the past few days criticizing the government. That's completely unprecedented. I think that he had been such a vocal supporter of the government previously. It's celebrated giving up his Canadian passport in favor of a Chinese passport. And as well, combined with the fact that we know that there's certain quarters of Hong Kong where resistance to what China's doing is still very strong, coupled with these more kind of outspoken pronouncements just in the past few weeks, driven by COVID, of course, but also kind of the rest of the community realizing that a authoritarian government is actually not in their own interest either. I wonder where that stands and where we think it can go from here. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheridan. I'm sorry you had to leave Hong Kong, but it's to America's benefit, I'm sure. It's an excellent question. And I think it's really hard to predict with any precision. I think I'd go back to the point that roughly 6 out of 10 people, excluding, I guess, perhaps some of those who left, but still a sizable majority of Hong Kongers want a free, open, democratic society. And, you know, we know there are little signs of resistance, whether they're little signs stuck up about free Hong Kong, revolution in our time, that might be stuck by a light switch or something, or, you know, Ukrainian flag was projected at various sites onto walls in Hong Kong, which is, again, is interesting. This kind of solidarity between Hong Kong and the Ukraine, Hong Kong and the Baltics. I think that we'll, you know, when the moment comes that the Hong Kong people will be out in the streets again. I mean, I think it's going to take a long, long time before the spirit of protest and the hope for democracy is beaten out of the Hong Kong people. I mean, they went through so much, not just in 2019, but really in the entire period from 1989 on. That's the first time we saw hundreds of thousands of Hong Kongers out in the streets. And that, of course, was in the run-up 8 years before the Chinese took over. And so in the past 33 decades, a whole generation of people have grown up which in an open society, believing that they should protest, hoping that their voices will be heard, hoping against hope because their voices haven't been heeded yet. And I just don't think that the people now, whether they're Martin Lee and Jimmy Lai's age or they're, you know, students, I mean, Joshua Wong was, I think, 15, maybe even 14 when he was leading crowds of 50,000 people out in the streets a decade or so ago. So Joshua Wong and many of these people are really hardened political demonstrators are in their 20s. So I think, you know, as long as enough people stay in Hong Kong, and Jerry's right, I mean, 300,000 are expected to take up the British offer to move under the British national overseas passport. So as long as enough people stay in Hong Kong, I think that the opposition will arise whenever there's a chance. You know, I just don't know how and when that's going to happen.
You know, as we consider the outreach, the extraterritorial clawing of the PRC and Hong Kong governments against people abroad, whether Chinese nationals or foreigners, we have to also consider this question: to what extent will the PRC now recognize when people who are Chinese nationals go abroad and give up Chinese nationality? Will they recognize it in theory? And even more important, will they recognize it in practice? When you mentioned earlier the case of the Chinese who became a Swedish national decades ago, it's an example of, in practice, the PRC is treating him and abusing him like they think they can abuse any Chinese national, even though he's a Swedish national. And if 300,000 people go to the UK and hundreds of thousands of others go to America, Australia, Canada, and elsewhere, and many of them say and take steps formally to renounce PRC nationality, will the PRC recognize that? In theory, will it recognize it in practice? This is a pretty important international law question. Next question, we're beginning to have to consider time.
That is actually it for the questions. As a reminder to everyone to ask a question, you can click on the raise hand icon on the Zoom window. If anyone has any questions, you can ask them now.
Mark, we have 9 minutes left. What concluding thoughts can you give us? What should be done?
Yeah, well, thank you for the opportunity. I guess I'd remind everybody to think of some of the remarks that Sharon made. We are in a very, very fluid time. On the one hand, it really is the worst of times. I mean, for us to be able to sit in our, you know, watch on our phones or on television, what's happening in Ukraine, that's, you know, medieval in its savagery, probably worse because more people are killed. And at the same time, to watch whether they're cynical, opportunistic businesses who didn't have that much business in Russia, or Russian oligarchs who are just hoping to hightail out of town with at least a couple of billion left over. Or I think, you know, as the majority of people who really now understand the importance of freedom. And I think that we have to keep our eye, it's very difficult, but keep our eye on Hong Kong and not forget Hong Kong. I was lucky enough a year ago, to moderate a series of live streams that Jimmy Lai did with prominent people around the world for a period of a few months. He did very bravely after the national security law came in. And one of the interviews that really stands out is Nathan Sharansky, who, of course, was a famous Soviet refusenik, a Jewish man who wanted to emigrate and was thrown in the gulag, was thrown in prison for years and years. And he made the point, Jimmy knew at that point he was probably going to jail. And he knew that Hong Kong was in the process of being destroyed, even a few months into the national security law. And Sharansky made the point that, you know, just don't forget the prisoners. I mean, they know, no matter how far out in Siberia or wherever they are, they know when you remember, they know that they're being helped, that you know, discussions like this are taking place, that people are doing everything they can to get them out. So I think above all, let's keep the spotlight on Hong Kong. Let's remember the brave, nonviolent people who are in prison, technically in prison, or I guess, you know, spiritually in prison, or with COVID. I mean, more or less the whole society is in prison. And we just have to keep fighting. I think more than ever, we understand the importance of fighting for liberal, open societies. I mean, these are things that weren't handed to us on a silver platter. And I think every generation perhaps is tested and needs to defend those values or to succumb to authoritarianism. And I don't believe that the alien rule of the Han Chinese in Cantonese Hong Kong is going to survive forever. And I think that what Hong Kong people have done in the quarter century since the handover in 1997 has been an extraordinary sense of openness and resilience and development of a Cantonese culture that's also an international one. So let's try to remember Hong Kong and try to remember, you know, there are many places, Xinjiang, Afghanistan, obviously Ukraine. You know, we are so fortunate and there's so much we can do.
Well, I agree with you, of course, and that's why we have this program and others. And yet there's so much talent that isn't taking the time to analyze, report on, focus on what's going on in Hong Kong. And I hope that this kind of effort will stimulate people to take a special interest, because what's taking place just in the court system alone in Hong Kong bears immense analysis, requires a great deal of talent, including from people who know about Hong Kong. If I were a Hong Kong solicitor or barrister, I would be better equipped to analyze what's taking place. And we need the help of people who are qualified, who are still based there locally, and who maintain their contacts even when they flee abroad. Because without their help, and if they're intimidated, whether it's because of relatives or business or just a personal reluctance to get involved in controversy, we are going to be the losers. And how to rouse people to a sufficient extent to escape their normal routines, that's a huge challenge, even if it means no challenge to their personal security. So this is a continuing effort. And Mark, we're very grateful to you. And I hope that your book will sell well, not only in abroad, but also in Hong Kong, and that booksellers who purvey it will not go to jail. And perhaps we'll even see your book turned into a movie someday. You're still young enough to star in it. Thanks. This was an extraordinary session.
Well, Jerry, thanks so much for your interest and your lifelong commitment to human rights, not just in Hong Kong, but in China, but really around the world. And yeah, thanks to the council and to all of you who took part, and to especially those who asked such good and thought-provoking questions. So thank you all.